I need somebody help, not just anybody help. You know, I need someone, yeah. Help was a big film and an album that came out in 1965. Of course, the lead song of it, Help, became very, very popular. And another song that came out on the album was essentially a soundtrack of the motion picture, was called Ticket to Ride. In 1965, July to be exact, Help was released during the summer. It was a spoof of the James Bond films. The Beatles themselves did not like the film very much. In fact, they felt like they were extras in somebody else's movie, but it did promote them a great deal in 1965. In 64, by the way, the year before that, they'd met with Bob Dylan. And Bob Dylan actually was a very big musical influence on them, and it became very strong in their background. By the way, Bob Dylan just won the Nobel Peace Prize, the Nobel Prize for Literature, rather, the Nobel Literature Prize for poetry. The lyrics in his songs were considered by the Nobel Committee to be poetry, and he's won the Nobel Prize for Literature. Well, let's get back to that Help album there. And of course, one of the songs that became very prominent on that particular album was Yesterday. This is a bit more introspective. You notice that the early songs that the Beatles did were more light and frothy and fun. But Yesterday is a much more melancholy, introspective type of song. The lyrics go, "Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. Now it looks as though they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Suddenly, I'm not half the man I used to be. There's a shadow hanging over me. Oh, yesterday came suddenly. Why she had to go, I don't know. She wouldn't say. I said something wrong. Now I long for yesterday. Yesterday, love was such an easy game to play. Now I need a place to hide away. Oh, I believe in yesterday." Ostensibly, the song talks about a young man, a person who's lost their loved one, who has decided to leave. And he, of course, is looking back and saying, I'm looking back at the good times that we had at the yesterday. This comes, of course, from the Help album. It's not as frenetic as the Help song or Ticket to Ride, which are much more upbeat, but it's a very good, thoughtful song, and I'll play it for you now. It's called Yesterday. Here we go. Thank you. Oh, I Believe in Yesterday, from the Beatles' Help album in 1965. 65 was a big year for the Beatles. They actually did some more touring. Their third tour, in fact, presented one of the greatest concerts ever done outside, the Shea Stadium concert, 15th of August, 1965. 55,600 people showed up. It was the most famous of all the Beatles concerts, although all the concerts that they did in every place they went were completely sold out, and they were really, really mobbed there in Shea Stadium in August of 65. Also, in that month of August of 65, the Beatles met with Elvis Presley at his home in Beverly Hills. And he, of course, had been a great influence on the Beatles. They broke out the guitars and jammed together. Can you imagine what a musical combination that would have been to be able to sit in and listen to these musical giants, the Beatles and Elvis Presley, get together in August of 1965. Well, another song that was written, actually published in 65, although it had been written sometime earlier, was a song called When I'm 64. And of course, the song on the surface looks like a gentleman that's talking to his girlfriend or his wife and saying, when I get older, losing my hair, many years from now, will you still be sending me a Valentine? Birthday greetings, bottle of wine. If I've been out till 2:45, would you lock the door? Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64? That actually later on appeared on the Sgt. Pepper's Band album, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, it was called. But the fact is, the song was actually written in a kind of a, almost like a vaudeville type of style in honor of his father, Jim. Paul's father, Jim McCartney, had been a performer in the 20s and 30s on the stage, a musical performer. And Paul actually wrote this little song in the style of the kind of music that his father had performed years before. So here's a look at When I'm 64. Of course, when you're 25, 64 seems like a long, long, long time away. But this is a kind of a comical song, a nice one anyway. When I get older, losing my hair, many years from now, will you still be sending me a Valentine? Here's When I'm 64, which Paul McCartney wrote in honor of his father. Thank you. When I'm 64, will you still need me? Will you still feed me? When I'm 64. Paul McCartney from 1965, actually. He had written that when he was a kid, some years earlier, and finally pulled it together, and it appeared later on in the Sgt. Pepper's Band. Another album that came out in 1965 was one called Rubber Soul. And the story I'm going to tell you now, the song I'm going to play for you, is Michel. Michel, my belle, son limon, qui vont très bien ensemble. You know that song there? I love you, that's all I need to say. Until I find a way, I will say the only words I know that you'll understand. My Michel. Michel was actually a song that he heard at a party, that Paul heard at a party. It was actually a French, kind of like a French melody. Later on, he put the words to it. It doesn't refer to any given person, but he liked the melody so much, and he tried to find a name that would work well with this, and the name that came out was Michel. Also, he had a friend whose wife was a French teacher, a French linguist and a French teacher, and he consulted with her on the lyrics, and he was trying to find words that would sound French and fit into the idea of this fellow trying to talk to this girl, French girl, who only understands French, to tell her about his affection for her. So I thought I'd play this for you here. It's Michel, ma belle, son limon qui vaut très bien ensemble. It's from the Rubber Soul album from 1965. Michel, ma belle. Michel, ma belle, son limon, qui vaut très bien ensemble. They're the words that go together well. Also on this Rubber Soul album, there were some great songs. Norwegian Wood, which is about a young fellow who comes home with a girl, expecting to have a night of passionate lovemaking. And he winds up having to sleep in the tub. It's called Norwegian Wood. You've Got to Hide Your Love Away, also from the Help album. And of course, I have to mention from Rubber Soul, In My Life, which tells, of course, about a fellow looking back at his life and the people that he's met along the way and how they've affected him and changed his life along the way. Speaking of people and how they've affected other people, probably one of the most interesting songs to come out of the Rubber Soul album was a song called Nowhere Man. And of course, it talks about a fellow who is ostensibly quite successful, doing quite well and all that, but it frankly has nothing to do and doesn't really know what's going on around him at all. He's a real nowhere man, sitting in his nowhere land, making all his nowhere plans for nobody. Doesn't have a point of view, knows not where he's going to. Isn't he a bit like you and me? Nowhere man, please listen. You don't know what you're missing. Nowhere man, the world is at your command. He's a real nowhere man, sitting in his nowhere land, making all his nowhere plans for nobody. Making all his nowhere plans for nobody. Here's Nowhere Man, which I think is a very nice commentary, if you will, on society or people who are just kind of floating along and really not in touch with what's going on. Originally, this was seen as a commentary by the Beatles on society at that time, talking 1965. However, later on, John Lennon said that he was actually talking about himself. He was in a period in his life where he was beginning to really examine who he was and what direction he wanted to take as a musician, as an author, if you will, as a composer. And he was talking about himself in this particular one, Nowhere Man, because he felt he was kind of like betwixt and between. Let's play Nowhere Man for you so you get an idea of how it sounds. Interesting song. This was a song, a very favorite song of one of my close friends. Making all his nowhere plans for nobody. John Lennon and the Nowhere Man, if you will, song from Rubber Soul. 1966 brought some really big changes in the musical repertoire of the Beatles. Another album came out. I keep mentioning these albums because the albums were really collections of songs that were written along the way. And this one in particular, it's called Revolver, the Revolver album, 1966. And it's an example of their repertoire that was expanding into all sorts of different musical styles. The Revolver album had some great songs on it, like Here, There, and Everywhere, which was about Jane Asher. I mentioned her before as being one of the sweethearts of Paul McCartney. He never married her, but they were together for quite a while, 63 to 68. At about this time also, George Harrison was emerging as a songwriter in his own right. You always hear about John Lennon and, of course, Paul McCartney, but the other members of the band also, especially George, were beginning to get into the songwriting part of it. And he wrote a book, a song called Taxman, because at this time the Beatles were subject to enormous taxes on their earnings, British taxes, the UK. He also wrote a song called Love You Too at about this time. Perhaps also the most famous of the songs to come out of Revolver was Yellow Submarine. Now, Yellow Submarine was actually a song written by Paul McCartney as a sing-along song for children. And it talks, of course, about in the town where I was born lived a man who sailed the sea. And he told us of his life in the land of submarines. So we sailed up to the sun till we found the sea of green. And we lived beneath the waves in our yellow submarine. We all live in a yellow submarine, a yellow submarine, a yellow submarine. We all live in a yellow submarine. And our friends are still aboard. Many more of us live next door. And the band begins to play. So it's called Yellow Submarine. It's a fun song, and it was written really by Paul for children as a sing-along type of thing. It comes out of the Revolver album, and it shows the different kinds of musical styles that the Beatles at this time were experimenting with. We're talking 1966. Here's a look at Yellow Submarine. This is always a fun song, and it's funny because people seem to know the lyrics of this instinctively. It's one that's been around quite a bit, as you probably can imagine. Let me get things set up here, and we'll go. Here we go. Live in a yellow submarine, a yellow submarine from 1966. I mentioned the Here, There, and Everywhere song, which is also on the Revolver album. And about this time in 1966, there was a great deal of controversy for the Beatles because John Lennon made a comment that by this time the Beatles were more popular than Jesus. Well, you can imagine this did not go over very well in the Bible Belt of the United States. But it was one of those comments that drew attention to the Beatles. And of course, Lennon was not a very much person that was very much into organized religion at all. Another song, kind of interesting song that comes out of Revolver, is a song called Eleanor Rigby. And this was unusual because in the recording they used an octet, an eight-piece classical string combination, and it fused kind of classical style along with pop style. By the way, Eleanor Rigby, there's a statue to her in Liverpool which shows her sitting on a bench, and a woman sitting on the bench, And across the bottom of it, it says, "All the Lonely People." The lyrics to the song say, "Ah, look at all the lonely people. Look at all the lonely people." Eleanor Rigby picks up the rice at a church where a wedding has been. Lives in a dream, waits at the window, wearing the face that she keeps in a jar by the door. Who is it for? All the lonely people, where do they all come from? All the lonely people, where do they all belong? Ah, look at all the lonely people. In a way, it is a commentary on modern society, because I guess you might say the further along we go in time, the more isolated individual people seem to be. They have all this social media and all this other stuff, but they seem to be more and more lonely, more and more isolated than they had been before. At least that was the tenor of this. By the way, there really is an Eleanor Rigby. That was not the original title. And some years ago, somebody discovered a tombstone in a cemetery that Paul used to cross through as a young boy. Maybe he saw the name Eleanor Rigby on the tombstone and remembered it subconsciously. But anyway, he tried several different titles before he found Eleanor Rigby to go along with this. Let me play Eleanor Rigby for you. It was a very, very strong song to come out of the Revolver album in 1966. Ah, look at all the lonely people. That seems to be the theme, if you will, going on here. Eleanor Rigby. Ah, look at all the lonely people. Perhaps the most popular masterpiece, as it's called in the books, that the Beatles came out with was, of course, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. That album synthesized a huge number of different kinds of musical styles and techniques. It came out in 1967. At that time, it was very new and very innovative techniques. It took over 700 hours of recording and dubbing and re-recordings to create the album itself. They used multiple mics. They chopped up pieces of tape, recording tape. They put variations on the speed of the instruments. All kinds of things were involved in that. Of course, in the Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band album, there were some great songs like, for example, Strawberry Fields Forever. Let me take you down, 'cause I'm going to Strawberry Fields. Everyone knows that one. Later on, an album that followed up on Sgt. Pepper's was called The Magical Mystery Tour, and songs like All You Need Is Love and Fool on the Hill, which was later on made into a terrific hit by Sergio Mendes and Brazil 66. But probably the most interesting song, in my opinion, to come out of Sgt. Pepper's was Penny Lane. Penny Lane is a song basically about an area, an actual street, in Liverpool, which Paul and John and George knew about as they were growing up. Later on, when they interviewed Paul about the song, he said that it brought back a lot of nostalgia for the places where they had grown up and visited. Penny Lane, there is a barber showing photographs of every head he's had the pleasure to know, and all the people come and go and say hello. Penny Lane is in my heart, in my ears, and in my eyes. Wet beneath the blue suburban skies, because it rains a lot. I sit and meanwhile back, Penny Lane is in my ears and in my eyes. Wet beneath the blue suburban skies. By the way, the barbershop has now become a unisex salon, and the Penny Lane area is somewhat of a tourist attraction in Liverpool itself. So let me play Penny Lane for you. It is a very good song, I think, and it does bring back the childhood memories. If you think back to the place where you grew up, you probably remember places and people and things that occurred when you were growing up that are kind of special to you. Here's Penny Lane. Lane, bringing back the nostalgic places there. In 1968, the Beatles went to visit with the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi into the ashram in Rishikesh, India. Other stars at that time, like Donovan, Mike Love of the Beach Boys, the flautist Paul Horn, and others had gone there to study transcendental meditations. There were a lot of songs written there, some of which appeared later on in the album called The Beatles, also known as the White Album. And there were other songs that came out of that as well, like Revolution. Say you want a revolution, well, you know, we all want to change the world. Another song that comes out of an album called Magical Mystery Tours is called Hey Jude, and this has become one of the signature songs associated with the Beatles over the years. Hey Jude is actually written for Julian Lennon, because John Lennon didn't pay a whole lot of attention to his son Julian, but Paul was a very kind of like a surrogate parent to him. And this song, Hey Jude, is actually written, you might say, to him to encourage him, because he was somewhat depressed as he was growing up, despite the fact of the wonderful, shall we say, fame that his father had attained. Here's Hey Jude. That's the lead from Hey Jude. That's all we have time to play for on the Hey Jude album there, on the Hey Jude song. There's another song that I do want to play for you. From May to October of 1968, they were in the studio, of course, and open hostility was beginning to show during the production of the White Album. Songs like Back in the USSR, Obladi, Oblada, there were problems among the group. Ringo Starr actually quit for 2 weeks and came back. Lennon was preoccupied with Yoko Ono, the Japanese girl that he'd fallen in love with, who was allowed into the studio, contrary to the band rules. And so when the White Album came out, the critics called it a shapeless outpouring of songs. There are two more songs I want to play for you, and a couple of things I need to mention. Abbey Road was another album that came out in 1969. And again, this is another example of how George Harrison was becoming a somewhat of a good music producer and music writer. He wrote Something in the Way She Walks, that strikes me like no other lover. And he wrote The Long and Winding Road. This is 1969. In 1970, their last album called Let It Be came out. And that that song was named after a song. The album was named after a song called Let It Be. You might know the lyrics to this because it's become quite popular and famous. It's been done many, many times, many covers. And the Let It Be album featured this song, Let It Be. When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be, let it be. The song was actually inspired by Paul McCartney, who at that time in the late 60s, we're getting to 68, 69, 70 now, was really beginning to wonder what was going to happen to the group. And he had a dream in which his mother Mary, who had passed away sometime before, came to him and comforted him and told him to hang on, that things would be all right, that music would be all right for him in the future. So let me play Let It Be for you, inspired by Paul McCartney's mother, who appeared to him in a dream, as he has described in some of the biographies and interviews that came out after it. Let it be, let it be. Paul McCartney filed suit to dissolve the Beatles' partnership 31st of December 1970. There were disputes, of course, about the finances and so forth, and the death of their manager, Epstein, in 1967 really put them into a tailspin. Anyway, the finalization came to dissolve the Beatles in 1974. Lennon, McCartney, Harrison, and Starr all released their own solo albums in 1970. Greatest hits and compilation albums have come out by the dozens since then. I want to leave you with one other song here. This one's by John Lennon. It was written in 1971 after the breakup of the song of the group. But it has such a strong message to it that I wanted to leave you our look at the Beatles with this song. It's called Imagine. Imagine there's no heaven, it's easy if you try. No hell below us, above us only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine there's no country, it isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for, and no religion too. Imagine all the people living life in peace. You may say that I'm a dreamer and I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us and the world will be as one. Let me leave you with this, our look at the Beatles, so we'll conclude with this song. It's called Imagine, from John Lennon. Imagine a very nice image, a very nice look, I hope, at the future. John Kinsley, Wizard Music. So long for now.